Hello, my name is Carmichael Patton. I am, as described, from Microsoft. We're in the security organization underneath Brett Arsenault, the CISO, in what we call digital security resiliency. I am titled as a principal PM, but I'm more functionally a security architect in the space and responsible for our zero trust internal program, along with a ransomware program that we're running as a satellite to this, and a few other things I do around container security, non-Windows systems, and things like that.
Hi, my name is Yulia Evgrafova. I'm on the same organization that that Carmichael. We are a security organization. We are part of what we call Zero Trust Core Team. It's a group of individuals inside Microsoft who defined what Zero Trust means for us, and we are driving the internal implementation. We came up with the roadmap for our internal program, and we track the progress towards the desired Zero Trust state. I'm a service engineer, and my role on the team is to evaluate the capabilities of security solutions that we have selected to deliver a zero trust to make sure that they actually what we think they are doing, and the service owners that are going to be running those services in production later on are happy with the capabilities of those solutions.
And we do similar sessions to this with smaller groups, clearly. We aren't slide jockeys. We don't really like slide decks. However, we are going to go through a set of slides for you guys today to at least talk about some of the lessons learned we have. We want to save about 20 minutes or so at the end of the session to open it up for questions. So if you have those, I know we've got some mics in the room, and we'll try to go back and forth with the mics as we do that. As I mentioned, we're not marketing. We don't look at Zero Trust in the same way that Microsoft sells Zero Trust. We are the internal organization, but an enterprise like most of you all are, where we're, as a business, just trying to figure out what it means to us. And it could be big, it could be noisy, and it could be confusing. Everybody talks about it differently, including Microsoft talks about it in one way, and other companies might talk about it in other ways. So we had to distill that down for ourselves. And the way that Brett thinks about it, and the way that we think about it, is really about three things. It's about the device, health, making sure that the devices that connect to our data and our resources are healthy and we can attest to those. And it's about the identities, so that when the identity of the person that's coming in, whether it's an employee or a guest or a partner, that those identities can be validated and we can put a level of trust assurance on top of those. And then very importantly, it's telemetry, ensuring that we have full telemetry of the stack to understand what those, between the identity and the health, make sure we can attest to risk, and associated to that to allow access in, but then also the telemetry we need to further our program, understanding where the risks lie within our program, and then prioritizing on those risks to how we deliver the program here inside of Zero Trust, inside of Microsoft. And so as we talk about this, even internally, we had to sort of distill it down, because Zero Trust has sort of a negative connotation. A lot of our users would say, well, you don't trust me if it's zero trust, right? That means, I'm an employee, you're paying my salary, I should be trusted, but you're telling me you don't trust me. So as we started kicking this process off and really thinking about what that meant, we distilled it really down to, in order to trust, you must first verify. It's not that we don't trust you, it's not that we don't want you to have access, it's not that we don't think you're valid or that your device is valid, it's that we want to make sure that you actually are who you say you are through multi-factor authentication, through passwordless auth, through things we do on the heuristics of the identities, whether that's UEBA functionality or other things we're looking at for whether or not that identity is risky or not when it's making that connection. And then it's ensuring, again, the devices are healthy and managed, and we'll go through what that means from our lessons and how we distill those policies down for the device level. Seems simple enough, right? We had a meeting roughly a month ago with a group inside of Microsoft, women of DSR, again, our organization's DSR, so it's our own security organization under Brett, and we asked them, when we say zero trust, what does it mean to you? What do you think about? And so we got a nice little word cloud out of that, and I'll take a minute and I'll just have you guys take a look at that. There's two things in that word cloud that should stand out amongst all the rest of them in a negative way. Somebody down here in the front row said the first one.
I don't believe you.
Trust deficient.
And then there's another one in there that just says, but. Zero trust, but what, right? And again, that's in our security organization. We do training, we do culture, like we try to change the culture, we try to bring the users in, we try to make sure they understand what it is. But even within our own security organization, there's still that level of mistrust or distrust of what we're trying to do from a policy perspective. I think it's super interesting, and we try to learn from that and really sort of change our messaging as we go through this over time, because it's not just Zero Trust isn't a product. You can't buy this product off the shelf. I think we all agree to that, and it's why we're here today, right? But it's also not a program. It's not a thing. It's a strategy. It's a cultural change. It's an understanding of how we should be doing business from a secure perspective in allowing the users and the devices to access that data, whether it's from a managed device or an unmanaged device, it's a guest user, it's an employee, or whatnot. So I mentioned that we think about it a little differently. If you've listened to any of the other market Zero Trust stuff with the new Entra that they talk about, my mic cord keeps slipping. there's like six pillars of it, but we really sort of, again, think about it from the device, telemetry, and identity. And then on top of that is the access. And that's not just network layer access, because a lot of what we actually connect to are actually in the cloud. It's how does a user access the data that they're trying to get to, or the application that they're trying to get to, and really understanding what that full end-to-end scenario looks like, and then trying to build into that. And then service is all the services that underlie under that, ensuring that we can understand what those services are, that we know how to get to that, and then you know that we can start planning for, and maybe even eventually looking at services themselves supplying health into this, because we have device and we have identity, but we don't know the health of the application necessarily that the person's connecting to. Is it a trusted app? Is it an untrusted app? Is it a third-party app? Is it risky, right? I mean, there's different tools that can evaluate that for you, but how do you integrate those things into your environment as well? And we talked about pervasive telemetry, and then the other big piece of this that sort of goes across all of it is least privileged access. That honestly is a little bit of a struggle for us because we've generally provisioned broad access to everything. You're a Microsoft employee. Again, we trust you, right? So you get access to all the apps that get created. In some cases, we've been pulling back on that from a least privilege perspective. But again, we have to think about LPA when we think about every one of these pieces of the clover here. Want to talk about this?
Yes, so which benefits Zero Trust gives and how to look at it from two different perspectives. So the thing that we realized through this work is that invest time in understanding in what is in what you're doing for the end users. So spend time understanding what it is in it for them and explain it to them. Invest into some education and awareness programs, have some kind of training, and work with your senior LT members to deliver the upcoming change to the users. Not only security organizations should introduce this change, but security senior leadership should work together with the senior leadership of other organizational units to deliver the message. We've learned that employees are much more accepting of the change and look at it more positively if the message comes from their own senior LT. So we structured our program in such a way that all LTs work together and deliver the message together. We also built the message at several levels. So the most simple level of what Zero Trust is being introduced even in our training standards of business conduct. Every single employee at Microsoft watches it and accepts once a year, so they all learn about it. There are levels, more detailed levels, that we discuss Zero Trust at with people who participate in our program who help us deliver on it. So what do we see benefits of Zero Trust for our users? Those are, you can get your device management compliant from anywhere that is convenient for the user. You can benefit from SSO experience once your device gets managed. And you get the intuitive workflow to get into a compliant state if for some reason you fall out of compliance. So those are the benefits that we say to our users Zero Trust framework and operating a Zero Trust framework gives to them.
Yeah, it really is like a teeter-totter, right? I mean, I think traditionally we focused on security because we had a lot of things we had to go do on the endpoints. We weren't doing a lot of management, and we'll talk a lot about what our roadmaps looked like. But we realized we were sort of forgetting about the productivity side of it. When we would have a major snow event in the Seattle area, if you're from Seattle, when it snows, Seattle shuts down. and then everybody goes home, and all of a sudden you've got heavy usage on your VPN that was your security boundary for giving access to the internal environments. So we've had to pivot to make more productivity, and so by the time that the recent things have happened in the environment, we've ended up with, when we sent everybody home 2 years ago, just almost nothing happened because we were already in the cloud, we had a lot of apps there, there wasn't a heavy reliance on VPN, and things like that, right? So we were able to sort of show that we could be secure and be productive at the same time, which we were curious how we were gonna be able to prove until we had an opportunity to prove it at scale. And then the other thing we talk about is passwordless. I like to put the hyphen in there because it's really passwordsless. I mentioned I work on a lot of non-Windows stuff, as Yulia does too, so a lot of the things we do in the Microsoft world on Windows, like Windows Hello and things like that, don't necessarily translate to the non-Windows systems, which will moving to getting passwordless there, where things like the authenticator app that we use for actually authenticating into systems. One of the things we've done in this space too is we really spend a lot of time understanding the culture of passwords inside of the organization, knowing that we had our red team that is part of our group that actually dumped all of the passwords minus all of the users, did a survey, you know, started looking through all of those, found things like Golden State 2022, for those that are NBA fans watching the playoffs, right? hands clap. You know, you see those types of things, right? So you see consistency in what being used, you can start building a dictionary, a database of what the passwords are and start blocking those types of passwords and really understanding what the nature of that is. As we continued through that cycle, we went from a 70-day password reset to a one-year password reset, and then without telling anybody about 3 years ago, we just got rid of password resets completely because nobody was needing to, because we had so much uniqueness in what passwords were being put out there that we really felt comfortable that there wasn't a lot of reuse or those other things to actually give a greater risk score to the passwords that are being used. And so that helps us then into the journeys, like I mentioned, into the using the authenticator apps and things like that to actually authenticate in. Now we're trying to get more into the phishing-resistant authentications to try to just even go that further. And we've got a pilot internally also with some of our folks to just, and you know, through entitlements, just not even issue you a password so you don't even know you have one. So we're working on that part of the journey too. It's been super interesting. I'd love to talk about that more if you guys are curious.
So zero trust access model. How do users access corporate resources when we operate in zero trust? First thing everybody must do in order to get access to corporate resources is register for 2FA, people, multi-factor authentication. People can register for 2FA from anywhere, from any device. Once that is done, people register, enroll a device into a device management system. 2FA is part of the process. Once device gets managed and the compliance security policies get applied to a device gets compliant, people can access corporate resources. The engine that verifies the identity health and device health is the conditional access engine. So one important thing here is to understand what is the full inventory of corporate resources that people are trying to access. Why do we need to do it? Because we want to track which applications do support the modern access model, applications that can enforce device and health verification, and which cannot. So once we have a full device, full application inventory, what do we do with that data? We find owners so that we can make sure that applications that do not support it yet have a plan in place how to get there. If they do not have plan in place how to get there, then what's going to happen with that application? Is that application on the deprecation path, or is there a new access model needed for it? Is it going to work through application proxy, or some other solution is needed? So that's why we want to understand and have a full picture of a complete application inventory. So while everybody was working from home, the interesting thing that we've learned is that 97% of the all connections that people do is to cloud applications already. Only 3% are on-prem. And we thought those were some kind of on-prem applications with whom we will have to work to modernize them. But turned out those are not even applications. Those are SMB file shares and SQL databases that people have in place and things like that. So that's what we've learned through the VPN data by examining all the traffic that goes through VPN. And to get the full application inventory, it wasn't an easy task by itself as well. A data from multiple sources has to be stitched together to get this end-to-end, to find all the application owners, to find out where that application is hosted and things like that.
Yeah, the VPN scenario is an interesting one because we've been fighting with our VPN team for a long time. We talk about telemetry as a big thing, and it wasn't, I don't mean fight in the way of like, we need your data. It was more they just didn't know how to give us the data. So we spent about a year and a half or so working on getting the data, and as of February 2020, we got access to data. We had this VPN Top Talker dashboard, and we're like, great, now how do we get data into there? Because we have, you know, maybe 2% of our employees on VPN at any given time, because again, we're split tunnel, and 97% of that traffic is going to the cloud, so we're not seeing a whole lot. But then, of course, like you said, we send everybody home. Now you've got this full rich of, you know, telemetry. We were taking advantage of it like gangbusters, so it was awesome. So when we talk about device health, this is what we mean.
Yeah, so what is the definition of device health for us? So this is the baseline that we do our best to enforce no matter what the client OS is on every endpoint. This is the bare minimum that we want to enforce. We want to make sure that device is up to date on OS updates. We want to make sure that device is threat and risk free. This is integration between an anti-malware solution and device management system. We want to make sure that device is encrypted. We want to make sure that device's integrity is attested, device not mobile device not rooted, jailbroken, secure boot is enabled, or system integrity protection for Mac is enabled. We're looking for application control functionality, even though that is not the factor that will break the access to your corporate resource. This is still a very important capability that we always look for. And we, of course, want to make sure that device is something that is officially supported by our device management system, not some one-off device of which we have three in the network, and that's it. So this is the bare minimum, and the goal here is that we want to get a consistent experience for IT pros as well as end users. We try to stay consistent so that our IT managers know what they are going to get no matter what system they use. They know which they will be able to enforce. And users, if they switch from one device to another or change device management or do things, they also already trained. They know what to expect. They know which enforcements are coming.
One of the other pieces that we learned when we were talking about this is really explaining it in a simplified way that everybody understood, right? So as we talk about a policy like the OS up to date, that's a minimum operating system. We have a policy or standard that says N minus one, so current version minus one, but that may not mean much to some people because they may just say, well, I've got an iPhone and iPhone updates when iPhone updates, right? Well, iPhone, and if you've been in the security group and you're doing vuln management, you know there's been a lot of Apple updates over the last few years. So we've had to actually shift from N minus one to N. You know, we are putting an enforcement on the current version because Apple says that we have to put an enforcement on the current version as an enterprise because we want to make sure that the vulnerabilities from the previous versions were all mediated or mitigated. So how do you go tell a person who now, as we start enforcing that, has to potentially get rid of a phone and buy a new phone when we don't issue phones? We're a full BYOD. We support BYOD across the board. So you got to be able to explain why you're doing it, why it's important to them, and then have them trust you know, and verify, I guess, that what we're saying to them is valid enough for them to actually go buy another phone for themselves. But because we are BYOD, we have the other options. Everybody gets a device issued to them, whether it's a Mac or a Windows device, in some cases Linux devices as well. You already have a device, you already have the connection you need to get in. So, you know, coming in with a mobile device, you're making a decision at that point. If you don't want to upgrade your phone, you want to stay on an old OS that you no longer are supported. So it's really about that communication piece and understanding. Yulia spent a lot of time with Defender for Endpoint and how we communicate what we do and what we don't do with that, and having to work out even capturing some of the log data and putting that into an FAQ to say, here's exactly what we see in the logs when you're asking us, do we see what sites you're browsing or what other actions you're doing on your devices, right? No, we only see these things. This is explicitly what we see. So being really clear in that communication on what we're doing so that there isn't any second guessing that. So as we put together our program, again, you know, Zero Trust for us is a program and a strategy. As we put it together, we have about 20 some odd scenarios, and every year we review those scenarios to make sure sort of what the status of each of those scenarios are, where are we at, are they done, do we accomplish what we wanted to accomplish, and then we evaluate those and reprioritize them as needed. And so what you see here is over the last year, what our top five scenarios have been. You know, again, we talk about identity and devices, those are our first two, right? And then we have the network segmentation, which is in the access lane. We want to be able to provide segmented environments, whether that's life safety offering, OT devices, operational devices, whether it's printers, conference room phones, things like that into another area, removing users from what would be our traditional infrastructure, CorpNet we call it, getting them out of there, putting them into an internet zone, and going. So again, another benefit of the pandemic, if you want to call, you know, look at the pandemic as being beneficial to enterprises, is that with everybody working from home on their own home Wi-Fi and 97% of their traffic going to cloud apps, why would they want to come into an office and connect directly to an internal network, have to go out some data center edge to where they're going to the cloud when they were already experiencing pretty decent throughput getting there? So we had to rebuild what we would call sort of that internet connections inside the office. We still have some management on there. We still do get some visibility and things like that. We don't use proxy, but we still have some of that visibility that we're getting there. And we moved most of the controls now to the endpoint using Defender for Endpoint. We use most of the controls there now to actually get telemetry from the client devices instead of relying on network telemetry to do a lot of that investigation stuff. And then the last one there is, again, the applications and services are built with mechanisms to do device health. We focused a lot on Hero app and making sure we understood what the Hero application was, and that was for us Office 365 and M365 suite of applications. So as long as you were connecting to your email, you were connecting to SharePoint, you were connecting to Teams, then you were going to get conditional access enforced. And so we just assumed, okay, if you're already connecting to those core services, you should already be on a managed device and healthy, and then you can connect to the other ones. But what if you aren't using those on that device? What if you're connecting to just your development tools or to your pipelines or to Git repos from those devices? We had to start now looking at how do we get those things behind conditional access and those applications behind conditional access. It's not an easy work because a lot of these things come with either legacy authentications for some of the line of business applications we have, whether they're using old Active Directory authentication libraries and they need to be modernized to the Microsoft authentication library. Mouthful. Making sure that teams understand what they need to do. Yulia talked about it, modernize their application to get it to a point where it can actually be integrated into this workflow. So that's a lot of work for us on that particular line item there. And you can see some of the actual goals we have within each of those pillars that we talked about, the cloverleaf. And the one I'll call out here is the experience lane. You know, we talk a lot, or have talked a little bit about the cultural changes we've had to make when we do zero trust. So it's a lot about in fact, one of the line items there is to have Yulia and I come talk to you guys and explain what we do here. It's about going to our users. Yulia mentioned the SBC, our Standard Business Conducts. It's a episodic adventure, if you want to call it, that our education awareness team does. That is fun, it's entertaining, it's educational, and at the end of the day, it's helping people understand really why we're doing what we're doing. So investing in those types of things culturally to, again, really understand the experience and really sort of promote the experience to the user so that everybody's on board with what we're doing here. So you can do all the other things technical-wise, but if you aren't looking at experience, you probably should, right? You want to understand what that experience is you're creating for your users in your environments.
This is our journey on the Zero Trust roadmap. This is not the only way to prioritize the work that needs to be done. This is a way that we have chosen. So you can see that before, on the left, before we started, in one side comment, the whole Zero Trust effort has been a huge alignment exercise for us. Across the company, many work streams were already in existence, work was going on, but those teams were operating independently with their own roadmap, their own schedule, their own goals and such. So what we've done for this program, we brought them all together so that they understand the dependencies, they run on the same schedule and all. So before we started working on Zero Trust, device management system existed, but there was no point in running in it really. So some people did, some did not. So when we started, it, same with MFA. MFA existed, but you know, some people would enroll, some would not. When we started the Zero Trust journey, our first priority was enforce 2FA everywhere, identity-wise. In addition to 2FA everywhere, we had a good example as an ultimate Zero Trust state is SO, Secure Admin Workstation, what we call. This is a separate environment where our admins do the administrative work, so they have special identity, they have special hardware, and this is the most restrictive environment. So we used it, we thought that it fits in our Zero Trust model and it serves as an ultimate Zero Trust case, so we kind of put it in and we started measuring other implementations for other scenarios against it as well. So the next priority after identity health was device health. So we started enforcing device health requirements for all client OSs that we have in the environment. What we've learned there is apparently Windows is the hardest one to enforce device health. We are done with all the other client OSs in the environment, but we're still not done with Windows. We have so many edge cases in the environment because we are creating it. We have so many variations of it. We have so many special scenarios. We're still working on it. The majority is of the work is done over there, though, so we understand what we need to do. It's just a matter of time and proper tracking. So another thing is, so next pillar in our journey is the network experience. So for the network experience, everybody used to be able to come on campus, connect, and get full access to corporate network. But what we've used the pandemic time for is people kind of forgot the habit of connecting to corporate network over that time. So we've changed user experience completely. We implemented network segmentation and we've changed user experience. Now when people come back to the campus, they have to go into a portal and select which device should get access to which corporate segment. If they choose to get connected to corporate Wi-Fi, they have to provide business justification. This has never been done before for our users. They've never had to justify why they need to have access. But now they do. And we have a good understanding of what are the scenarios that hold them back, why, for how long, and we have a full inventory of devices that get access to corporate network as well. So are we done with Zero Trust? Well, not yet. We have milestones in mind, what we want to do there. But again, this is one way to do it, one way to prioritize, and this is a question that we get asked often. How do we start? Where do we start?
So a little bit about our program itself and the way that we work. Yulia mentioned we're the core team, which is in the bottom left over there. So if you think about the slide for a second, everything on the left side is more of an enterprise work. Everything on the right side just happens to be because we are Microsoft and have access to the Microsoft product teams. So, you know, again, where you guys are playing is more over there, and that's where we play as well. So we're the core team. We set the strategy. We work with other architects across our organization, whether it's in security or in infrastructure IT. And we all sort of understand what playbook we're working from as far as our strategy goes. What are we really trying to accomplish, whether it's the network segmentation, whether it's the device health policies we're looking at, identity changes and other things we're working on. And then we have, you know, those are those work stream leads that we'll also work with. So there'll be different teams, whether it's those implementing our, you know, turning off or scaling down VPN, or if it's those that are working on the network segmentation or those that are working on the actual policies. Those teams, we do a weekly meeting with them to get a status update, make sure we all understand where we're going. If there's issues, they can bubble up to us. And we can escalate them. And then each of the organizations, so Brett Arston and his peers, or his directs and their peers across the organization, I should say, that's that general manager's work stream. So we have a path of escalation. And when we were putting the program together, as Yulia mentioned earlier, it was a lot of different teams doing a lot of the same thing. But nobody was really relying on the other as they were planning. So you may have had one team that was planning for a portion of, you know, within the sprint or the half of the fiscal year, and they had a plan here, but your plan was over here, and the two plans weren't really syncing. So this was a way of bringing everybody together and really syncing, but then also giving it a financial responsibility too. So if you were running into problems, if there was hardware that needed to be bought, that they weren't screaming into a canyon trying to get somebody to pay attention. We had a centralized method of evaluating what was actually needed, so then we could go with a budgetary ask for the program all up and say, hey, we need, you know, more Catalyst 4000s to actually do some additional work in offices that have old network gear, right? To make the support the network access controls that we're trying to do, right? So now we have a centralized body of people that are really working on it. And then we go up to that escalation level there where the CVPs, so all the corporate vice presidents, you know, we could go to them with some of those funding acts, resource asks if there's more bodies needed and things like that. Every, I think we're actually quarterly now on the where it says monthly, but we have a steering committee. We started this, when we first started Zero Trust, before it was even really talked about at Microsoft, we brought together a bunch of the CVPs across all the organizations, like Office, Windows, Defender, you know, all those different teams, and we said we need to all understand how we work together. And so this is how we formed our steering committee. So we have a group that we meet with pretty regularly where we all talk about our challenges, the issues we're having, and how we get to those, how we resolve those challenges. So they're not just resolved for us, but resolved for you guys too, hopefully. And then, like I said, we have syncs with pretty regular syncs. We've got a red zone item. So if you submit issues to Microsoft, you probably have done something similar to us where we submit issues and then we track those issues with our product teams to try to get to resolution. We want to get to Q&A, so I'm just going to throw up this slide on key considerations. I think this is probably the most important thing we want to make sure that we take away as our lessons learned. Without telemetry, we couldn't make any decisions. We really didn't know how many devices do we have, how many users do we have, how many guests do we have in our network, what's the risk of all of those connections, and what's going on. So it's really just about collecting telemetry and making sure you can understand that. Get to modern identity and MFA. If you can, you know, go to your identity platform that supports this, whatever that is. Make sure that you have, you know, the right modern identities. You can do that policy enforcement so that, you know, you're gating your users, you're gating your devices until they can be challenged on the policies that you're deploying, and then go forth. And then, you know, again, CA enforcement. The thing we didn't really talk about is that our CA, or conditional access enforcement, or policy enforcement, we do hourly refreshes of that, if not more often, depending on if there's issues in the environment. So every authentication gets a token. That token lasts 1 hour, and then it's refreshed, and the entire cycle is re-evaluated and rechecked. And if anything's wrong within that refresh, then something goes away. Every 24 hours, we refresh your MFA token. So if you've MFA'd once, you can have that for the day, and then you have to re-MFA. You may have to MFA. There may be websites that force MFA throughout that 24-hour period, but that's because we've put stronger requirements on those to reinforce. But just in general, that's what our refresh rates are, 1 hour and 24 hours. So we can keep talking. If you guys wanna ask questions, please come up to the mic. We're happy to take them. We have our first victim, I don't know.
Oh, I'm not the victim. Yet.
Perfect.
Not the victim. Two questions. One is with respect to authorization, right? Because authentication is the basis, right, for doing any kind of trust, whether it's least privilege or zero trust, right? If you don't know who they are, you've got no business interacting with them. But once you know who they are, you have to authorize them. I didn't see, or maybe I just didn't perceive, where you talked about how you construct that, because in my experience, that's usually the hard thing, right? Organizations build, they fall back to 30 years ago and they go with role-based access control, and they have this picture of putting people in AD groups, and they build these giant monoliths of privilege for you know, all the Microsoft employees have this huge monolith. And then when you decide that it's not appropriate for somebody to have access to one application, wow, you have a hard time tearing that down. So how did you get to authorization, and where is that supported in your model?
You didn't miss it. I briefly talked about it, but it wasn't really in a clearly articulated way. We don't do a whole lot with authorization other than give everybody access to everything.
Okay.
I'm half kidding, half not, but by default, up until about a year ago, every application that was created within Azure Active Directory, all FTEs were added to it, all FTEs. Didn't matter. If you felt like your application needed to be opened up to vendors and support staff, then it would be all FTEs plus vendors would be what you would add to that. But by default, every application, and it was a function of the tool itself and a function of us just as a process not wanting to change the tool necessarily or forcing a change in the tool. So we just did that by default, which is not, please don't do that. The tool supports not doing it now, don't do that. We have FIM for a lot of the security groups, and we have way too many security groups, which, you know, you're articulating. It's definitely on our roadmap to really try to understand that. And there was a birds of a feather session earlier, we were talking about role-based access control, and I'm gonna use that term because it's familiar with a lot of folks in the room, right? But what we're trying to do at the point of entitlements, when we're actually providing a user with something, is we want to really understand what that user persona is, what they should have access to, pre-provision that access for them to the things that role would dictate. And then as they need it, we're using things like access packages that are time-bound or require some level of acceptance for that access package so that you could then get elevated in some other role or some other capability. So we do that in some cases there.
So something I pushed on our AD folks in-house for about a decade ago was finding a way to get away from AD groups and get away from this building of a monolith, right? Using groups as a container into which to put people, as opposed to using a group to envision some kind of an access, right? And then assign that as a privilege or an authorization privilege to a user temporarily and then take it back or whatever. Are you or is Azure AD moving towards what I call attribute-based access control, where the user has an attribute that's evaluated at access time to determine whether or not they need it, as opposed to looking at the user and going, oh, you're part of everybody, you can, right? Yeah. And then you can, it's easier to matrix attributes, right? Create a policy, evaluate for an attribute, get a result, as opposed to try and create a matrix. This group has these things, this group has these things plus one, this group has these things minus one.
I honestly don't know what the product is doing in that space because we're not the product folks. I couldn't speak to that specifically, but it is something we're trying to figure out at a persona-based level of how do I define a persona and what does that persona have access to, whether it's an IT admin, whether it's an engineer, whether it's an info worker or something to that effect, which I think you could attribute those types of attributes and then measure that in. I appreciate your understanding because I think that would be the right way to go personally. I just don't have any foresight into what they're actually planning, so sorry.
So to add to that a little bit, it's understanding creating roles inside Microsoft environment is very hard because of the creative nature of what our people do. Each person has many functions, and you can't clearly attribute each person to just one function. All of us have informational worker functions, a bunch of us have also some development functions, a bunch of us have, in addition to that, or just administrative functions. That's why it's very complicated to define user roles inside Microsoft. So we're still gonna be working on it. It's like not solved for us yet. But our next milestone for Zero Trust is least privilege access. So we're gonna be focusing, it's gonna be our next pillar, and we're going to be focusing on least privilege access from four different perspectives. Data, network, application, and endpoint itself, right? So all those challenges are for us yet to solve.
Yeah, let's jump over here for the next question.
Okay, thank you for sharing the information. Okay, I have just one question here. All the focus on any Zero Trust presentation puts more emphasis on connections made from endpoint to corporate resources or anywhere in the cloud or on-prem. Have you ever come across a scenario wherein a need for a corporate entity need to talk to the endpoint, or an endpoint has to talk to another endpoint? And how does the Zero Trust architecture come into play for this?
So if I understood the question correctly, what you're asking is there an identity that would be used to get access to an internal resource or from resource to resource?
Have two remote endpoints. They need to communicate a peer-to-peer communication or something like that.
Sure.
Or a corporate entity need to talk to an endpoint which is remote.
Okay. I wouldn't say we have a strategy necessarily in the way that you're defining it, because our strategy is more just about endpoint as a client connecting to a service. But we are challenged, when we talked about our scenarios, and you know, now that we've gotten past the hero scenario, one of the issues that we have that we're finding out very quickly, we dismissed wanting to do anything with a Zero Trust strategy with Azure because we had our own Azure security program for how we want to protect Azure resources. The problem is, as soon as one of those resources wants to access one of the things we're putting behind conditional access, you now have to worry about that endpoint providing the health data, right? Which I think is the direction you're going in. There are some streams that we use where we use managed identities to do some of that. So if it's a service-to-service connection, you're using a managed identity, which could then be excluded is not the right word, but you could have that as its own process outside of the conditional access workflow. So as long as you have that managed service identity between the two endpoints or remote
endpoints.
I'm
not even talking about a service-to-service connection. I'm talking about more about a service to an endpoint. Say, for example, that might be a need, okay? Some company might be still using SCCM to push software to workstations. So they may be doing a polling of all the workstations, and then I would say, if it is active, okay, push the software to them.
You know?
I don't think we have any.
Yeah, I don't think we're doing any of that. It's basically, I mean, we just do, right now we're still using Config Manager to push some updates and things like that, but there's no, I mean, that has its own processes and stuff
that's
like that.
That's just an example I'm having. Yeah. There may be, a support tool used for taking remote control of the system to do something.
Do you want to talk about, from our standard user perspective, what we're doing with the help desk? And I think that may be closer.
We don't have a perfect answer to your question, but there are some like mitigating things in place, right? That's the hero app approach that we talked about. Because every single one of us has an information worker function and checks Exchange, for example, or SharePoint, the device from which that connection is being performed is already highly likely to be managed and compliant. So connection from one endpoint to endpoint is not necessarily subject for explicit, very clear zero trust checks, but the endpoint, both endpoints are highly likely already to be managed and compliant, right? And the flow that we use today is we rely on the quick assist for help desk to troubleshoot other endpoints remotely,
I don't have a good answer. For it. Sorry.
Thank you.
Hello. You said that you fully support BYOD devices. Given the number of employees at Microsoft, how did you overcome possible pushback from employees to get their devices managed, because I know that's what I deal with.
Yeah, so we touched on a little bit when we talked about sort of the cultural changes and a lot of the communication training, the SBC that we have and stuff like that. So we use that as one of the vehicles for doing that, like make security everybody's problem, right? It's not just ours to solve, we need everybody to pitch in. That goes so far, right? That you still have, you saw the slide with the word cloud, right? But I don't trust you. One of the things we talked about lessons learned, we didn't really go into the details on this, but when we were first doing mobile management, which was honestly like one of the first things we started doing, again, because Windows was hard, we actually had started and stopped because we would get pushback from different organizations. One of the organizations we got pushback from, I won't mention, but they happened to be an app that everybody here probably uses for communication, and it was not working well with our conditional access enforcement that we were trying to do. So what we did is we enforced them first. Again, because we're Microsoft, we had the ability to enforce that team, and so that got them to figure out what the problems were with their workflow, and then we could actually then roll it out again. But to get to your actual question, one of the pauses we had to make is as an organization, the only time we ever supplied devices was when it was regionally required for us to supply a device. So if a country says you have to have a work device separate from a personal device, then we would buy you a work device for that. But we hadn't really thought about, well, what happens if somebody says, well, I don't want you to manage me, right? I don't trust you to do that, I need a device. So we actually spent a good 3 months or so trying to figure out what that program would look like, who would be allowed to buy one, who wouldn't be, what were the roles that should have one, what the roles that shouldn't have one. We were already doing a lot of stuff in the space with like our sales folks, field engineers, things like that, that were giving them an allotment to spend on phones, to spend on minutes and data and all that sort of stuff, but we weren't really doing the other side of it. So once we did that, we then had a program, we restarted again, started pushing it out again, but we felt like, what ended up happening is we had done so much, we felt like we did really good communicating of what we could and couldn't see. I talked about how we actually show them some of the stuff we can actually see in logs and stuff, that more and more people leaned to the productivity side and actually enrolled their devices. So we didn't see a lot of pushback. I think we got 5 users or so that pushed back, and we actually gave one of them a device. There's others that did push back and just said,
so nobody complained
myself.
That you could spy on them just because you managed their device, that you didn't have that type of stuff?
We absolutely heard all those arguments.
Oh, yeah.
We had to address them through our internal communication channels. We use the privilege of being inside Microsoft and the direct access to the engineering groups that create many applications. So what we have done is we've made, when possible, terms of use part of the enrollment process. And when possible, when you are setting up a new client application to access corporate resources, there is one of the steps is a step that says what IT admin can see from your device, what IT admin cannot see from your device, and what this data is going to be used for. So we've explained this in many, many places, and that seemed to have helped.
So transparency.
Yes, transparency, educate your people on what's going to be happening, why, and transparency. It's part of the public documentation now, it's part of the, where we succeeded working with the product group to implement it. It's part of the application setup process, it's part of our internal guidance, how to get your device managed compliant, and by the way, these are the policies that we are going to be enforcing, and this is what we are going to do with the data that we see, so yeah, all that.
Okay, thank you.
I'll be quick. You've got the 5 minute.
I did.
Hey, real quick, on this BYOD MDM, are you guys effectively going through and limiting what apps can effectively be installed on BYODs? And are you restricting access to Microsoft Corp resources from container spaces therein that prevents the hodgepodge of various type of apps that everybody uses on a personal basis from being able to go through and perhaps impact those apps that you're then using to facilitate connection to corporate resources?
So we don't sandbox in the way as described. So we do full device management, right? So but we don't do any allow listing or block listing unless an application has gone through some sort of vulnerability review and we said this application can't be supported on a device, and then we will do that. But on your personal phones, it's your, like, well, let's focus on Apple for a second, right? Like, no, we don't do any forcing of, okay, of restriction of applications there. On Android, we were doing full device management with the original Google Device Manager. When they switched over to the Android for Enterprise, we actually switched over to that. We were locking it down. Like, you couldn't shift things back and forth, because what we heard and what we were trying to do was, we don't want to be able to copy and paste across profiles. We want the work to be separate from the personal. That's what they kept telling us. We want work from personal. And as soon as we did it, what did we hear? Well, I gotta tweet something. Yeah. And this is from people who would have like social media accounts that are actually supposed to be doing these things. Well, I gotta tweet this email I just got. And I'm like, okay, but do you have to copy it over? Well, yeah, that's how I do it. I'm like, okay, so you don't want separate from work and personal. You want some correlation there. But Android does give us the ability to actually have that separation. So also the other things we heard from people was, well, I want to be able to shut it off at the end of the day. I can't do that on my iPhone, but I can do that on a work device or an Android device, because I can hit the work, the business or whatever it's called, I forget. And then just turn off my work at night. I don't have the work profile, but we don't do any of that type of stuff that you're asking about.
And just a follow-on question, unrelated. As it relates to Zero Trust, are you guys doing anything specific relative to developers? I saw that you actually had SAWs for your administrators. Yeah. How are you effectively achieving Zero Trust for a developer community?
Yeah, so that's been a bit of a struggle, especially Yulia's working to understand your user progress through the LPA program we talked about. It's really understanding that dev persona and what they need access to. There's some new things that are out there that we're really interested in. Let me touch on a scenario real quick. Like, what we have engineering teams, when we sent them home for the pandemic, where all they were provisioned before that was a high-powered workstation that sat under their desk back in the office, plugged into the corporate network, doing all of their builds and things like that they needed. So now they go home. They can't take that workstation home, or don't want to take that workstation home, because they want that connection back into the office. So how do they get access into that workstation? Well, they were just creating a desktop RDG into that workstation from their home PC, but now we don't want them doing that, because we don't want an unmanaged device connecting to a managed device that has now connected to full corp. So we used virtualization to create remote desktop gateways so they could hop into a box that was in VDI and then into the environment from there. That worked for all of a short period of time until they realized they could somehow get around that in some cases and started getting around it again. So those are some of the scenarios we're trying to figure out there. Some of the other scenarios from unmanaged perspective, just to dovetail on that, is all of our partners now go through VDI. So if you're working with us as like an Accenture or a PwC or KPMG or the other ones, right? We don't issue devices any longer. We say, okay, you've partnered with us. We're going to create a virtual a VDI session for you, so you can actually come in and get access into that environment and do work with us, because you're already on a managed device that your company's issued for you. We don't need you off of that. We just need you to have a secure access in, so that we move heavily to the VDI to do a lot of that stuff. So,
okay,
Okay, got two question about two different identity types. One being your B2B, you keep referring to it as vendor and stuff like that. I'd like to understand how you tackled those guys. I mean, typically you have a scenario where you have a contractor. You can either put him in your system and have him be a true user, or he can be kind of a guest invite. I'd like to know kind of what you guys did in that realm. And then the other type of identity is non-human identities, not necessarily an MSA account, but your legacy, this user account is running a service or something like that, right?
Well, I'm sorry, was there a question?
How did you handle those two types?
Sorry. We do have to worry about that. Yeah. I've talked about vendor and partners that we work with. We still issue them accounts inside of our environment, so they get a what we call V-dash account, vendor access. There's some other dash accounts that we give to depending on the role that they have. And then we just issue through that, through VDI, but they get access the same way that an employee would get access to it. If it's a customer that we work with or some external party that we work with that isn't a vendor or relationship with that, it just comes in through SharePoint's share channels or team share channels, and they get a guest account in our environment. If I'm sending a document to somebody externally through our AIP and I've tagged it in a way, then they have to actually create a MFA and authenticate to actually get access to those documents. But it's a guest account, right? Like a B2B, B2C type account. On the non-human accounts, that's actually part of our below the line of the five that you saw there. That's one of those strategies. How do we worry about non-human accounts? Because it's been interesting to go from sort of where the original service accounts, service principles were, to managed identities and really understanding how those work. And then I talked about the dev scenario where they're working on a Linux box, and they have to get access to something. They're working on a Linux server in Azure. Well, the Azure manages all of that through policy. We have all of the policy we push out to servers. But how do they get access into a conditional access world? So does that have to be through that user account? And does that now that server have to get enrolled as that? So there are challenges we're still trying to work through on the non-human accounts, and we might start moving to non-human accounts to manage some of those pipeline type things. So, and I see movement, which means my 1 minute is up and we are over time. But thank you, everybody.
Thank you.